Okay, so let's continue on with Python. One thing I want to talk about real quick first is autocomplete. So in the window, if I, for example, import math, I can do math.tab, and then I can see all the things that I can get from math, right? If I try and do the same thing in here, import math and math dot. If I do tab, it just inserts a tab there. If I wait, pops this up, but I don't like waiting for it. So what you can actually do is control space, and that will pop it up immediately. So if I wanted to autocomplete this, it'll see maybe I want math, max, all that, map, whatever. But control space will show it up. If you want to auto insert it, then you can actually do. See, there's the control space for show completions, and then there's the expand word. That's alt slash, and that will auto complete there. So just some quick tools when dealing with the shell that you can use. So now let's go into a little bit more on printing. So we've talked about printing. We know we can do print and just insert a number. We can do print, we can insert a space, all that. Another thing we can do is if we just want to, let's say we have variable A is one, and we just want to say A is one in the string, we can do that. But we want, instead of needing to manually type in one here ourselves, we can make it populate it for us. And the way to do this is using fstring. And so to do an fstring, you do f and then the quotes. And you can see if you do this, the f turns green as well. So it sort of recognizes that it's all as one piece. Then when you do this, anything within curly braces, it will just calculate out. So if I put in curly braces A in the string, it will just replace the curly brace A curly brace with A. If I did A is A plus 11 and calculate it in the curly braces here, it will compute A plus 11 and then put that into the string. So it makes it really fast to do a lot of things. Makes it much faster. And of course, if I do this, it will just print out the curly braces until I add that F, and then it works grand. So another thing with printing is with print, you can have multiple inputs to it. And the first is your string, but the second, you can use end equals, and this will specify what to put at the end of this print. So if I wanted to print b equals 3, or let's say b equals 3, we want to print out b equals and what b is equal to. But I want it to be this and then comma space this. Then if I specify end is blank string, then I can achieve this because it swaps. Normally, end is a new line. So like right here, if I do or don't have this input, it gets the same thing because this is the default, end is a new line. But like I say, if you want to swap that, you can swap it to whatever you want, and then you can just get that out there. There's other ones. As you can see here, the main ones are sep and end. Sep is if you have multiple strings, say I have 1, 2, 3, and 4, I can then say sep, and I specify what separates each of these strings. So if I run this, 1, 2, 3, and 4 will all be separated by a space. If I put in a comma space, then it'd be 1, space 2, space 3, space 4, because whatever the sep is what's put in separating each of these. That's some more fancy stuff with printing. Just comment that out. And now let's go into the next thing, which is another thing that's nice about Python. Is it uses the English language pretty well. For a programming language, a lot of times you have to use weird formatting and things in order to make it work, right? But Python allows for pretty close to actually English in the way you can format some. So far, we've been focusing on processes that work a lot in other languages. Let's see some more Python-specific ones. So one thing is if you want to check multiple conditions, right? We know that you can do that with and or. The alternative way of doing this is with and or, literally just the words. So if I wanted, for example, 1 is less than 3 and 11 is greater than 15, you can actually just put an and there instead of that and character, and it'll work just fine. You can do or, and obviously the and will be false. So let's print this out. The and will be false because these aren't both true, and or will be true because one of them is true. So that's a nice thing about Python. Another example of this is, so we know we can import math, and then we can import it as something. So if I wanted to import math, but I wanted it to be called, every time I called up math, I just want it to be M, for example, then when you do this, you can use M in space of math. So m.sine of m.pi will work instead of math.sine, parentheses math.pi. You have to be careful, of course, because then you can override to say, I do m is 1. Now if I try to do same thing, I'll get an error because m is 1 now, it's not math. So you have to be careful, of course, but that's an example. This is pretty close to the English language, right? Import math as m. An even more extreme example, you can do from math import sine as synrad, let's say. And what this will do is it will let me use sine from math as synrad, and then I can do m.pi because I've still imported math as m. So synrad is a function. I've named it synrad, it used to be sine, and it's from math. So all of these are valid ways of doing things, and it's sort of a fancy thing with Python that you can structure things that that make a lot of sense. Just looking at it and reading it out, you could basically interpret, if you know what an import is, you can interpret from math import sine as synrad just using English. So those are some pretty cool things. Now, let's look into actually writing and reading from files. So, writing to from files. Writing to from files is the programming jargon for creating files, putting things into those files, and then taking things out. So, just called writing because they inherited it from writers. So, if you're trying to put things in a book, you write it down. If you're trying to put things in a file, you write to it. So the way we can do this is we can create a variable f, let's say. You could of course name this whatever you like, but common choice is f, and then you can use the function open. And as you can see, there are a couple options here. First is the file. So this will be a string with the file name. So let's say I wanted to open filename.txt and filename. Practice, let's say. And let's try it with just this. If I then look at f, I could say a is f.read, and then at the end I want to close f. So first, what's happening here is I'm opening filename practice.txt. So I'm looking for that file and opening it. Then I'm trying to read from it, and then I close it. This close is very important because otherwise it can cause errors. If other programs interact with this file at all, it can cause it to be corrupted and you don't want that. So always be careful to do the close. But when I run this, I'm going to get an error. And this error is file not found error. And it just says no such file or directory, file name practice.txt. So I tried to read from it, but it didn't work. So now I'm going to comment this out and I'll actually write something to that file so there is something that I can read. And the way I can do this is and say file open test, let's just call it the same thing, file name practice.txt, and then the second input here. So this mode equals R, that's the default is R, but you can do R, W, A are the common ones. So R, W is to write instead of read. So read means you can only look at what's inside the file. You can't actually put anything into it. So it's just observing the file instead of doing anything to it. Writing is you can put stuff into the file. A is appending or putting stuff at the end of the file.
Here's a list of even more modes.
So let's try each of these. First, we want to write to this file, right? So here I'm going to do f.write, and I don't need to set some variable equal to f.write because what I'm trying to do is just write to this file. I don't need it to be something in the Python world. I don't need a variable housing it. I just want to put something in the file. So here I can do testing 1, 2, 3. So let's just put that, and then we will close it. Then we can try this same thing, uncomment it, and run it. If I print out A, I get testing 1, 2, 3, because that's what was in my file. So let's actually pull up my file explorer, and this is where I've got my lect2. You can see it's right here. And inside here is my file name practice.txt. And so you can see it's actually made it. It's not just something in Python. It created a file and I can double click and open it and it's got what I put into it. So that's pretty cool. I could also, after writing to it or instead of writing to it, I could run this again and do A. And then if we open this again, should have this twice. And indeed it does because I appended to this file instead of writing to it. So here I've got that. Often, of course, you'd want to do a new line before appending. So now if I look at my file name practice, it isn't updated yet. So I got to close it, go back here, open it again. Now it shows it. So, very nice. And that's sort of the short and long of files. There's a lot more to it, but that's just how you can do a general read and write. Another way of doing this, as I said, you always want to do the f.close or whatever name you used your file as. If this were file, of course, this would have to be file.read and this would have to be file.close. But an alternative way of doing this, you can say with open and do the same file, file name practice.txt, and I'll open it. It's write, so this will override it, of course. So with this, I do as, and then this will be my file, f. Then in here is all the stuff I do with it before I automatically close it at the end, and then I go on with my code. So file.write, test, 1, 2, 3, write A, B, C. Let's do a new line for that. And let's say I had a few variables. A is 11, B is A plus 3, C is A plus 11. Then I could do f.write. And I'll do my F string now. And I'll do A is A, new line. B is B, new line. C is C. And of course, it will just replace the curly brace C, curly brace, with the value of C, and the same with A and B in the curly braces. And then I can do whatever else I want down here. And once I look at my code again, or my output, you can see I've got ABC. I forgot to do a new line here, but you get the idea. I did test 123123 because I'm writing, it didn't add it to what was currently in there. So you have to be really careful if you're like writing to a text file and you got important stuff in there, you're gonna overwrite it if you use W. So very important to be aware of that. Then I've got my A is 11, B is 14, C is 22, all that. So very cool. And I didn't have to do my f.close at the end there. So that's working with files. That's kind of all we'll go into it. There's a lot more to it, but you can figure out more if you want to deal with specific types of files. Like you want to work with images, you want to work with more complicated putting lists and stuff in there, you can do all sorts of things, but that's sort of all we're going to go into now with that. So the main thing we're going to talk about today is classes. And classes are some of the things we've already seen. So if I say A is 1 and I do type of A, I'll get what the class of A is. So this A is of class int. And the classes I've mainly seen so far are int, float, strings, lists and dictionaries. So that's cool, but let's say I have a need for another type of class. So these are the built-in ones, but I want to make something different. There's a thousand reasons why you'd want to do this, but we'll just sort of look into how to create it, and then we'll do some examples on what specifically you could apply it with. So first, how to create it. Well, as you may be astounded in knowing, first you type in class space, and as you can see, it highlighted it in orange, or it changed the text to orange, saying that this is a specific thing to Python. So now it recognizes that this is trying to define a class. So then you give the name you want for your class. So this is like a variable name or a function name. You just give it some name here. And I'll just call it class name for this example. And now you get to define class attributes in here. Now, class attributes are things that are shared between every instance of a class. So an instance of a class is like A right here. I created an integer, but it's in its own variable. So this is an instance of int. If I create B is 11, B is another instance of an int. So in instances of certain classes, we have class attributes that are shared between all of the instances of that class. So to make an attribute, it's like a variable. I just say attribute and I'll just call it attribute one. This is again like a variable. You could call it whatever you want. And I'll say it's zero. And then I will define. So this is a function within this class. And this is a method. When it's a function within a class, they call it a method. So the first thing you want to do with classes is you do underscore underscore init underscore underscore. And this creates an initialization function for this class. So initially in here, you want to feed in self. And what this self actually is unlike if I created a function in it, I'd have my input 1, input 2, input 3, input 4, and they could be whatever I wanted them to be named. But let's just say I do input 1, input 2, input 3, and input 4. It doesn't have this first variable defined in the just normal function. But when it's a method, when it's a function within the class, you first give it self, and then you do a comma, and then you give it all the inputs you want. So if I wanted to do the same thing as this function, I would do self, and then input 1, input 2, input 3, and input 4. Close it off, have my colon. And then in here is where I can define the data attributes. So up here is the class attributes. This is where if I call up attribute 1 from any instance of a class, it will always be the same value. If I call up a data attribute, it can be different for each instance of that class. So now we'll see what you actually use this self for. So this self is just referring to this class, this instance of this class. So if I want to store a data attribute in this instance of this class, I can do self dot, and the dot means it's within this instance of the class. Then I can do input 1, for example. So let's just say I want this input 1 stored as a data attribute in this instance. I can then say self.input 1 is input 1. And it's much like defining a variable. I'm just saying this, which is the instance of this class, and this data attribute within it is input 1. And I could call this whatever I want. If I wanted to call it in 1, whatever. It just has to be something like a variable would be named as. Whatever I call that, I make equal to this input. And often in classes, you end up doing self.input1 is input 1 and doing that with all your inputs. But you don't have to. This is just a common thing that you want to have stored in your class what your inputs are so that you can use them later. So we'll look at an example of this real quick. If I do it with all of the inputs, then unlike normal functions, you often don't want when you just initialize a class to return something. So I won't bother to return something, but I will go ahead and do something that's common with class attributes, and I'll make it so that every time I create a new instance of this class, I add 1 to this attribute. So one thing that you can use class attributes for is to keep track of that number of how many you have. So I'll do that here. I'll call up what my class name is. In this case, it's just class name. And I will do period to say within class name have attribute 1. And I just want to add 1 to it. So instead of make that equal to, I can do plus equal 1. And then class name.attribute 1 is class name.attribute 1 plus 1. So now if I just have this be my class name, let's just start with this. And to actually make a variable that is this type of class, create the variable test variable, I can make it equal to class name. And then I want to give it the inputs. And like I said, self isn't really the first input in actually calling up this class. Self is just feeding into this function what the current instance of the class is. So I'll just give it what input 1 is. Let's say I want input 1 to be 1, input 2 to be 2, input 3 to be 3, and input 4 to be 4. To do that, let's delete this function down here. I can say that, run this, and now when I look at test variable, it's a variable that I made, and it should be of the type class name. So test variable, it says main dot class name object at this. So that's probably a little bit confusing, but it's just saying what this is because it's not just one or whatever. It's an object, and the object is within main. So within this file is why we get the main, and we get dot because it's within this file. So within this file, we have a class that's called class name. So that's where we get this, and it's an object that is that object at, and then this is like the location to the computer where this class is stored. So this doesn't necessarily mean a lot to me, but what I can do with this is I can call up, for example, attribute 1, and I'll get 1 because there's only one time I made an instance of this class name. So that changed from 0 initially to 1 when I created it. And I can look at specifically for this instance, my data attributes. So I can do input 1, but it's not self. Self is this class. So I say test variable dot input 1, and I call up for this instance, the data attribute within it. So of course, if I did dot input two, I would get two because I made dot input two equal to my second input. So this is the very basics of creating a class and creating an instance of that class. Now, let's create one more instance of the class, and we can see test two, class name, and let's say all the inputs are two. Now, if I do test two dot attribute one, it'll say two, but if I do test, and then I can use control space to auto fill that, and I do attribute one, I get two as well. So when I created this new class, it updated attribute one, and because it's a class attribute, it changed it for all of the instances within that class. So pretty cool. And of course, the input one would be different because it's not a class attribute, it's data attribute. So test2.input1 will be two, whereas testVariable.input1 is one, of course. So now I can create another method in here, and I'll call this str with double underscores around it. And double underscores actually mean pretty specific thing to Python. So it's saying these are actually methods that it calls up when it's dealing with this class. So init is what it does when it first creates the class. str is if you convert it to a string, what it outputs. So right now, when I print it out, it just prints out this big thing that's not very informative. Or it's informative, but it's not necessarily what I want to see if I print it out. Maybe I want to see what input one is every time I print it out. To do that, I just feed in self. And so this means when I feed it into a print or when I convert it to a string, I don't feed in anything because I don't have my first input being the second thing here. So I just, every time I convert string, I run this. And let's say again, if I want to just show input one, I can return from this string of input one, but I can't just do input one because that's only defined in this function. The only thing I have here is I have class name, so I could refer to the attribute, but I also have self, which is this instance of the class here. So string of self.input1 is what I would have to do. Now if I run it and I print out this test variable again, it looks totally different because it's not printing out just that it is an object and where it's stored. It prints out input one. So this lets you kind of frame when somebody prints out your class, what they see from it. And anytime you use underscore underscore str, that's what that's used for. So now let's create, unlike these special methods for this class, let's create a function that we can just use with this class. Because to actually use this str, I can do test variable dot underscore underscore and control space will give me a list of all these methods here. And if I did str, it says bound method, blah, blah, blah. And again, prints out something similar to this. But if I were to actually call it up as a function, use the parentheses, but don't actually feed in any inputs because it doesn't need any inputs, then I'll just get one out. So again, when I'm printing it, all it's doing is running this, and then it's printing out that string from it. So if I want to have another, let's say I want to be able to run a function from class name, and I'll just call it custom function, and I want to be able to feed in two values, and it should just return input one plus these two values. So the way I'm going to do this is I define a function in that class called custom function, just matching this, same thing, right? And because it's within the class, I do self first, and then I give it two inputs, and I'll just call it A and B, just for ease here. And I wanted to return self.input1 plus a plus b. Now, when I run this again, I can actually, took it away. So just write it out again. Test underscore variable dot and custom function. And I just need to feed in a and b, as you can see it, pop that up. And let's say I want to add input 1 to 11 and 15. I'll get the input 1 for test variable is 1. So I'll get 1 plus 11 plus 15, which is 12 plus 15, which is 27. So that's sort of the structure of a class. This particular class, I can't think of much use for, but this is how you would actually set it up, right? So now let's look at, we saw str here, but let's see test variable dot. And if I do control space, it'll give me attribute one is a thing in it. That's the class attribute. Then it's got the custom function, and then it's got my data attributes. But I can also see if I do underscore underscore and then control space, I can see a lot of different built-in methods here. So you can just do that if you can't remember, like, was it string or was it str or was it print? You can look in here. Okay, I don't see a print, but I see the str, not see a string. So it must be str that I'm trying to use. But anyway, you can see other ones as well here. And the ones I find myself using the most are add. And this is self. So if you were to write it in here, to use add, you feed in self, and then you feed in the thing you want to add it to. So that actually lets you use, when you define add, I could add test variable, and I could create another class name with 2, 3, 4, 5. Right now, that gives an error because it doesn't support plus. When I add the method add, whatever I return from add is what it will do. So if I just find this here, add self and the variable it's adding to, so I'll just call it A. Let's say I just want to return 0 every time I try and add in this class. Oops, to close this off, right? So now if I try and add one instance of this class, so I'll call it class name 1234 plus class name of 111. Then I'll get 0 because it'll always return 0. Of course, you may want to like add input 1, input 2, input 3, input 4 to a whatever you actually want to do with your add is what you would return. But just as an example of how to use it, you just return from your add method. So the next one I use a lot is sub. So this is just like add, but you use it by subtracting. Want to multiply, you'll define mul, and as you might guess again, add, subtract, and multiply basically have the same structure. They're doing the same thing except slightly different arithmetic, right? Str, we already talked about. Bool is if you convert it to a bool. Equal is checking if it's equal to something. So those are the main ones I use. You may find you use other ones a lot more. Just depends on what you're doing with it.
Here's a few more.
Now, let's look at a slightly more useful class. So this is a class where, let's say you're really tired of keeping track of units and you want Python to do the work for you. So you want to do arithmetic, you want to have Python be your calculator, but you don't want to have to keep track of units every time you're doing some calculation. So we'll create a class that keeps track of units and allows us to do operations like add and multiply. Okay, so what I have might look something like this. Let's say I've got a object, and my object in this case is going to have two parts. It's going to have a value, and it's going to have a unit. So first thing I might try is
Let's go with a value that's just some number, say it's 10, and then a unit that's some string. Let's say it's something like kilograms. So this is the way I'm going to actually house this object, and then I want this object to be able to add and multiply and print it out in a usable manner. And when I print it out, let's just say I print it out as 10 kilograms with brackets around it. So it's just the value, space, and then bracket with the unit. So this is how I want it to look. Now I have to actually create this in Python. And of course, when I think about this, with the addition, I want to only be able to do it with same units, because I can only add kilograms to kilograms. I can't add kilograms to meters. So I want to make it give me some kind of error when it tries to add things without matching units. And then multiply will just combine units. So yeah, hopefully that makes sense. So I'm going to sort of try this and see how it's working in Python. So let's do this whole thing. So I'll call my class Val, and it'll just be the, or let's call it var. So it just has this variables information. So as I always do, I want to initialize it, give it my first thing as self, and then it's my first input. That'll be my value, and the second input will be my unit. Then I can make the instance of this class have a val of that value, and the unit match that unit. Then I can add with the double underscore, so that'll just make it so that I can then add two of these vars together and it'll know what to do with it. So self, and I'll just say var2, because I'll be adding it to another var, so it makes sense to me. And then I'll say I want to only add if it's the same units. So if self.unit matches the variable I'm adding it to, unit. So if this is true, then I can return and I'll create a new variable. And you can create an instance of a class from inside this class. So that makes it very useful. I can create a new var from within here, and it can just return when I add these two things together, it can return that new instance of this var. So I can create this new var with the units matching. So for the second input, I can just do self.unit, or I could do var2.unit because they're the same thing, right? That's what I just checked. And then I want to add self.val and var2.val together for my value. Then, otherwise, I want to return none. Now, let's see what exactly this does. I'll do var, say A is var of 1 and seconds, let's say. B is var 11 and seconds. Then if I print out A plus B, what happens here? It prints out this object, but if I did M, it does not, right? So that looks like it's working as intended, because when it's mismatching units, it doesn't work. So great, now I can put in the mult. It's just mult, right, to multiply. And I do self bar two. And this is a little more complicated with the units, but the value is gonna be basically the same thing. So to do this, I can just return bar once more. New var self.val times var2.val, and then the unit is going to be, I'm just going to put those two units together. So I'll do an f string to make this simple, and I'll do self.unit and var2.unit, and this should automatically add in. Say C equals A plus B,
MD equals A times B. Now let's check. Yep, looks like we close parentheses as needed. So we can do C dot val, C dot unit. So that looks right. 11 plus 1 is 12 in matching units. Now B dot val is 11 because 11 times 1 is 11. And D dot unit is seconds. So that looks right. Works pretty well. And then I can make it easier so that print it out. It just prints out some string rather than this complicated thing here. So, because right now if I just call up B, it's this big thing. And if I print D, this big thing. So now if I make it so that when I convert it to a string, it looks like the number space. So the number will be self.val space bracket, and then the unit is self.unit. Now, if I were to print A, I get 1 in seconds. Looks good. Now, if I were to print C, get 12 seconds, and print B, 11 seconds. Okay, this looks pretty nice. It's a pretty simple way. It allows me to keep track of units and stuff, but there's a couple problems with this. Let's say I had something like this. So I've got a variable with a value of 10 and a unit of meters multiplied by a variable with a value of 15 and a unit of kilograms. I add this to a variable with a value of 10 and units, meter, kilograms. So when I print this out, it does it just fine, right? Because when it combined these two with multiplication, this unit became matching with this, so I could add it together. The problem is, if I were to have something like this, then it will become none because it no longer has matching units. It becomes kilogram meter instead of meter kilogram. So I probably want to go back to my problem here. And maybe string isn't the best setup for my units. But I want to store some string information, like kilogram. I just also want to be able to maybe store a list of units, so kilogram, meters, but this again could be in the wrong order. So other than a list, we also have a dictionary that we've talked about. And basically what I could do here is I have kilograms and I just have 1 kilogram, and meters and I just have 1 meters. And then I could use this number to keep track of how many kilograms and how many meters I've got. So for example, newtons is kilogram meter per second squared. With this, how I'd store this is in a dictionary with kilograms is again 1 meters is again 1, and seconds is now -2 because it's in the divisor here and it's squared. So this is maybe a better way so that I could add everything with 1 kilogram, 1 meter, and divided by 2 seconds is known to work together. Because if I look here in Python and I create a list with A being 1, B being 2, C being 3, if I create B, that is misordered here, so they still have matching values with each key, but they're organized differently. C is 3 and A is 1. If I check if A equals B, this is true. Whereas if I said B of B is 10, check if A equals B, this is false. So it matters what the value is and what the keys are, but it doesn't matter the order. And so looks like this works. So basically, I just go to my class, and I'm just going to have to reorganize this so that it handles the units as a dictionary. So I'll just make a note here, value, numerical value of variable, and unit, a dictionary as unit. And just say something like, example, program, meter per second squared, second per second, equals kilogram, 1 meter, 1 second, minus two. Whereas, if it were meter cubed divided by kilogram per second, this would be meter 3, kilogram minus 1, second minus 1. So, I keep self.val as value, right? I'm not changing anything about that, but I want to see if type of unit is, and I've got a couple of options, but the one I'll look at is if this is a dictionary, then so I'll replace this. If unit is a dictionary, then my self.unit is that unit. Otherwise, self.unit, and so in this case, I'm going to assume if not a, or instead of every other case, let's just say else if type of unit is a string, and here I'll have unit colon 1. So I'll just assume I have a string, it has a single unit in here, like meters or kilograms or whatever, and has just one of those. And then else, I don't know, maybe I'll figure it out later, but for now I'll just say else self.unit is none. So now I'll have to change add and multiply and string a little bit, right? Or at least check if they are working. So my add, I
can still check
if my unit here matches the unit with my var2, so this still works, and it should still return val plus val and the unit. So looks like this is still fine, and I'll just have to work with multiply a little bit, and instead of this, the value will still be the same, right? But I will have to have a revised dictionary with my new unit. So new units. And how I'm gonna do this is I'm gonna start with the first dictionary. I'll start with self.unit, and this will be my new unit. And then I'll go through every key in the unit that's adding to. So go through all keys in var2.unit, and for each of those keys, add it to existing dictionary, or if it's not an existing dictionary, add the new key and value into the dictionary. Okay, so pop back into Python and let's keep this up just for reference. Okay, so where are we at? We're in here. So first I'm going to start off with the old dictionary, the dictionary of self unit. Now I've got all the units in this dictionary, and I can just add. So like if I had two dictionaries, kilograms one, and same thing for the other one, kilograms one, all I have to do is add these numbers together, because then it's kilogram, kilogram, right?
So that makes this pretty simple. So I can make this comment and I can say 4. And this is because I'm going through all the keys in var2.unit. So I'll say for unit in var2.unit.keys. I'm getting each of the units from var2, because .keys gives me the string of kilogram or meters or whatever it is. So with that one, I want to check if this is a key in the existing dictionary. So if unit in new units.keys. So this looks in new units.keys, which is what my current self.unit is. And it says, okay, is this a part of that? Does this one I have in var2 match something currently in my units? If so, then I can just do new units of that unit and then add to itself the var2.unit of that unit. Okay. Otherwise, it is not in the current keys. So all I want to do is make it a new one. So new units of unit equals, don't do the plus equal because there is no unit for this unit existing currently. So this just equals the value in the var2. So then turn the var, and I do again the self.val, select below, times var2.val. And instead of this string, I can just do the new unit. And it's not in the for loop. It should be after all this is done. So there we go. Unless we have any typos or it's not working quite like we think, this should work, right? And we'll also have to change the string a bit. So for this string, what I'm going to do is sort of similar to what I did in multiply. And I'm going to start off with new units as a string. And I'll just add to the string as I go through the dictionary and put basically the count of how many there are there. So then we say for unit in self.unitKeys. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to add to new units, which is the string. And just when I add to a string with another string, I'll place it at the end. So I'll take the current unit that it's talking about and do it to the power of self.unit of that unit. Now what it should do is it does unit to the power of however many of those units we've got. So I could then just return new units, which should show when I've gone through all those units. And now when I save and run this, I get none. And that would make sense because I'm still adding in a kilogram space meter, which it thinks is like all one unit. So here I'll do kilogram colon 1 comma m colon. And now, oh, for this string, I don't just want the new units, right? I want the value as well. So say self.val space brackets, the new units in it. So there we are, 160 meter kilogram. So that works pretty well. And one thing I could do to tidy this up is add a space after every new unit. But that does make it so at the very end, there is an extra space. So what I'm gonna do, units is new units, and goes from the start to the end, one before it. And because minus one is the end, goes one before the end here. And let's see, if I do this, it takes away that extra space at the end, but it gives a space between all my units here. So let's
do another test. That works just fine with my C. You can take a look at C real quick and verify. If I were to print C, C is A plus B, and looks like I have this weird thing here because this should just be 12 seconds, right? But for some reason, I'm getting seconds squared. So if I do C is bar of 12 and seconds, that does it right. But for some reason, when I run this, I'm getting C is weird, and if I look at D, D looks normal. So interesting. To see maybe what's going on here, look at a couple more examples. So I'm gonna do is put in some tests here. And I'm just gonna say test one is var 15 meters, or test two is 20 meters, test three is 20 meters cubed per second squared. Then I'll print out what test one, test two, test three are, and then I'll print out what test one plus test two is, what test one times test two is, and then test one times test three. So if I say this, run it, I get test one is 15 meters, great. Test two is 20 meters, great. Test three is 20 meters cubed divided by second squared, perfect. Test one plus test two should give me 35 meters, perfect. Because when I add 15 to 20, I get my 35 meters. And then I should get this for my test one times test two. And then for test one times test three, should get 300, but I'm getting m to the fifth divided by second squared. Well, this isn't quite what I expected. And that's because I should be getting meter to the fourth, right? Because this is just one. So when I add them together, why is it not giving me meter to the fourth? Well, see, I can take a look at what test one, two, and three are now, just to see, did somehow these change what test one, two, and three were? Well, if I take a look here, test one is now completely different. So this is quite the conundrum, is it not? I've got test one, test two, test three. Two and three are great, but test one is not. So why might this be? And if we're trying to figure out, what we probably want to see is where this went wrong. So what I'll do is in between each of these, I'll print out what each of them are, and then see at which point it's going awry. So this looks good. This looks good. Now, test one is now meters squared instead of meters. So that's weird. That's right after the multiply. So maybe there's something wrong in my multiply function, the method for my class, that would cause this to happen. And to see, we could do some printing out and stuff.
And please take a moment and see if you can figure out why this is happening.
But the reason this is acting weird for us is the way a dictionary works. So if I were to create a dictionary with A of 1 and B of 7, say that off, and then I say B equals A, if I were to change, so now B is of course just the same thing, if I were to change the A to have a value of 15, if I were to pull up B, change B, perfect. But if I were to pull up A, it also changed A, even though I didn't change it like this. So the reason for this is when you say B equals A, you're basically linking these so that they're shared information. So it's not really creating a new dictionary, it's just looking at this one as well. So if I want to actually create a new dictionary, the thing that I have to do is C is A dot, and if I do control space, there's a method here, copy, and now C is the same thing, but now if I did C of A is 1, so bring it back, if I look at C, I successfully changed C at A to be 1, but if I look at A and B, they're still 15. So this is a dictionary that I just set equal to, and this is my unit or the first thing I'll be multiplying. So test 1 times test 2 in this example, right? So what it's doing is when I multiply, test 1 is being changed because I'm changing self.unit, even though I didn't realize it, just because new units is changing. So what I have to do, this is the same thing as I showed there. And now I can do dot copy. And if I hide each of these, and if you don't remember how I'm just with a keyboard commenting this out, if you look at format, comment out region, it's alt and 3. So you can use alt 3 and alt 4, or you could configure it with the new keybinds and get that right. So now if I run it, let's see if that solves our problem. And looks like it keeps test 1, test 2, test 3 all to be matching. And indeed, it converts this now to M4 because it's not taking what turn test 1 into of M squared and putting it in to add to the fifth. So pretty interesting, and lets us have a lot of flexibility when we want to keep track of units. So we could do a lot more fancy stuff. Like when we initialize this, we could say if the unit is G, then divide 1,000 and make kilograms. If unit is centimeter, divide the value by 100, make unit meters, and so on. And we could do tons of fancy stuff with this. That's the awesome thing about being able to create our own thing, is we really have the chance to have all sorts of flexibility. So I'm not going to go into how you do each of these. You can recreate it yourself if you like. But this way we could add and subtract and multiply all sorts of variables, and Python will basically take care of it for us. It'll only let us add it. If they're matching, it'll only let us multiply. It will always let us multiply, but it'll keep track of the units properly so that we can then see. And I could do lots of fancy things with printing this out. I could say I only want to add that unit if it's if self.unit of that unit. So whatever this power is, if this is 1, then I want it to, instead of doing this, I just want it to show the unit. I don't want to show to the power of 1. And then I could also say, if self.unit is less than 0, then I could say new units, and instead of doing to the power of self.unit, I could say I want it to say divide by unit and just take the x of the value of the unit. So let's see if this works. Now my to the power of 1 is taken away, just simplified it to just be m, and when it's to the negative power, it just does divide by that. So, you know, there's a ton of flexibility here. It really opens all your options. And yeah, now let's say I really found
this class super useful.
Well, one thing I can do is I can have this lect2.py, but now I've got my new file, and what I'm going to do with it is, let's just say I'm messing around and I want to call this on, and I'll just put it in here, and I want to use that class that I just made. So there we are. So I want to use var from this file. So it's not defined in this. I don't want to have to copy over my entire class and everything. I just want to be able to use var from lect2. Well, just as I imported stuff before, I can say import lect2. If I try and run this, it'll give me an error, module not found error. Now, if I get this error, I do a couple things. So a fancy thing in Python is try, and basically what try does is it says, try and run this section of code. If it fails, if I get an error, then do the except. You can also specify certain errors. So like if I specify this error, else, or except, module not found error, then do something else. And the reason this isn't working is because I'm not in the same directory as this file. But let's say I don't want to. I'm working in a different folder, but I still want to have access to this. So the way you can do this is first, I ran this. One, could I just try feeding in this string to the import? Oops, copy a brand name. Say, accept that, none. What happens here? Gives me an invalid syntax. So I can't just make this a string. I do want to do lect2.py, which I'll just refer to as lect2. But what I'm going to have to do is add this to my path. And the path is where I look for variables. So the way I can do this is if I say import sys, S-Y-S, is short for system. And then I can see what my path is with this. Just print this out. This is my current path. So all of these places is where it will look for my lect2. But it's not in these. So in order to add this, this is just a list, right? So what I can do is I can add into the list, so I can append to the list, and in appending to it, I want to put where lect2.py is. So I'll just copy this, and find out error. And if you get this error, what you want to do is put an R in front of your string here, or you can make the slashes into double slash. So I'll just make it R, and then when I import it, it runs this file, right? And then I can say A is var 1 meters, but it doesn't let me do that. And the reason is because what I did is I imported lect2. So what I have to do is similar to how we were using things from within math. So what I have to do is lect2.var of 1m, and now you can see it pops up that autocomplete because it understands it now. So if I were to print out A, it is the 1 meters. So that's how you can use classes and you can use functions and stuff from other files here. Now, there are several different ways to do imports. So let's look at a few. We already have the import lect2 that we know. We can also do from lect2 import star. That just says import all the functions and classes with their names. So it would import var so that I could just use var instead of lect2.var. This is not recommended because it doesn't let you pick. You may be importing some stuff that you're not expecting. So you want to be really careful using this one. What you could do, it's from lect2 import var. And then you would just be able to use var normally. And now I could say A is var of 1 here. And I can print it out just fine. So that's a good way of doing it. And you can also import functions using this. You can do whatever. You can also use as, so from to import var as variable. And along with this, there are a ton of other ones, right? We slightly mentioned this one earlier. So there are tons of different ways to do this. Now I'm done with that, and let's go ahead and we'll look at one more
class.
Let's do another example. Hopefully illustrates another way to use classes. Let's say you have a specific type of object, and instead of it being just like a generic variable, what I want now is, let's say we have a 3D printer. Now, with this 3D printer, we have the nozzle, and it's got a certain position, it's got a certain temperature, and with this printer, it has G-code, it has some material. So we can create a class that will sort of house this information for us and let us perform a couple operations. So this is like, if you wanted to control a 3D printer, how might you do it? You could create a class that allows you perform the operations to either generate the G-code or whatever you might do with that. So let's look at Python here, and I will go ahead and comment everything out here so that I can start fresh with this. And I'm going to create my class 3D printer, but I don't want to start by trying to say 3D printer is 11. It'll say invalid syntax. So I want to put an underscore at the beginning. And then I can define the init, initialize my class, and I want to say position, temp, G-code, and material. And let's say by default our position is 000, temperature is 0, our G-code is empty list, and our material is empty string. So we'll just create data attributes here. So for this 3D printer, the position is the position, the temp, the G code is the G code, the material is the material. Then, let's say we want to be able to move it. We could create a function that will move self, and then have your delta, we'll move this by default 000. And maybe it doesn't make sense to have default here, because why are you moving it if you're not moving it at all? So we'll have no default. And we'll have move equals 4 and in range of 0, 3. Then it will say self.position at n is delta. So delta should be a list like this. And 0, 3 says, or if I look at list of range 0, 3, it's 0, 1, 2, so it'll look at 0, 1, 2, and it'll say the position at 0, 1, 2, and it is, it's not directly this delta, it's adding the delta to it, right? So that's my move, and I've got heap, and this is, again, got some delta, but it changes the temp to be the current temperature plus the delta temperature. And then I'll have, when you want to print out this, or when you want to make it a string, what it'll do is, I'll do my fancy string, a string, and 3D printer. I'll do a new line and some spaces to sort of tab it in. So let's say I just want it to look like 3D printer. Spaces, nozzle at some position, let's say 0, 0, 0, and temperature of 0 C. So I could do this with 3D printer, new line to space, nozzle at, and use curly braces, self.pos, new line, space, space, temperature of dot temp space C. So giving us, oh, close this So now if I were to create new printer is, and let's just say I use the default. So starts at 0 degrees, no G code, no material, enter. Now new printer.us will be my default one and solid temperature, G code, material, all that. And I want it to print out the new printer. It will then structure exactly like this 3D printer, the colon here, and then nozzle at this position, temperature of this temperature. So there we go. And we could do lots of more stuff like this. This is just sort of to introduce you to the layout of what this would look like if you wanted to create an object that's your 3D printer. You could have a function like gen gcode. Gcode for a 3D printer basically tells it how to move. So to generate some gcode, you could just send it a bunch of moves, and let's say every time you move this, it keeps track of it in the gcode so that it generates it. Now, just putting on there, but that's an example of how you could actually apply this, and then you can copy that into some gcode and run it on a printer. So that's that. And a couple more things to think about. What does it look like if we don't feed in the string method? And seen this before, but let's just review. Create this again. Now, print out new. It just tells it that it's a object and where it's at in the computer. So that's what happens if we don't have this. And if we added a add method like we had in the var one, what would that mean? Well, for this object, it might not make any sense to add a 3D printer to anything. What would that even mean? So I have a move function for this class, but I don't have an add because I don't know what it would mean to add two printers together. You could do things like your printer has only a certain amount of size, so you could specify the size of your printer and then limit the movement. So you say if the self.position that you get here is greater than the current bounds, then make it equal to the current bounds so that it stays within that and it can't get outside of the printer boundaries. So yeah, this is a bit about classes and how you can create your own and use them. So hopefully that made some sense and you learned something. So thanks for watching.